Bismillah, walhamdulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, Assalaamu Alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome to a new talk. This one is going to be about a hadith that states that the halal is clear and the haram is also clear, but in between them are issues that are unclear. In this talk, you will learn the history behind this hadith and the narrator who reported this hadith, why it was said, and what the real meaning and the real purpose of this hadith narrative is. Because when I remember in my old days when I was a student, this was one of the early hadiths that was taught to us. It was drilled in our heads and even given a status that I will explain a little bit later, higher than the Quran. This hadith single-handedly removed the Quran from the equation. This hadith is the chief manipulator that gave absolute authority to humans over Allah's Islam. You see, we are told that the haram or the halal are both clear and well defined. So when someone comes to you and says that the halal is very clear and very defined, and so is the haram very clear and very defined, you feel at ease. Alhamdulillah, I know where I am headed. But then we are told that between these two, and I mean the halal and the haram, are unclear and undefined matters. But then again, the majority of people do not and cannot know. However, there is a small portion of people that do. In other words, the majority should always depend and be at the mercy of the minority, because the minority knows those things, the in-betweens, and can help us navigate our path to safety. The consequences of this hadith narrative are clear in the life and behaviors of Muslims and have been as such for centuries. You see, Muslims have been turned into this never ever sure of what is halal and what is haram. And in most cases, they always find themselves asking the minority, and by the minority I mean the men of religion. And by the men of the religion, I mean the sheikhs, the scholars, the preachers, the Islamic institution, the mosque, the one who makes adhan, the one who has a long beard. All these who speak on behalf of Allah, they are considered men of religion. So you find the majority always going to the minority to ask how to behave in almost everything in their lives, from what to eat to what to wear. People ask me questions, is apple vinegar halal? And they ask you questions about what color should they wear? Is red halal or haram? Even the hairstyle, if they go to a hairdresser, is this look halal or haram? Women are not allowed to have any hairstyle that would resemble a quote-unquote kafir. Why? Because the kuffar are hated by Allah. And the Muslim woman finds herself like a cave woman because any hairstyle that she has resembles somebody who is somewhere and is, quote-unquote, kafir, as the religious institution always said. So the hadith, the halal is clear and the haram is clear, and in between them are confusing matter, is really at the heart of the confusion. Let me put it in context. I am going to use here the parents' analogy. And what this hadith is telling us is exactly like if you are a member of the family, they have 5 kids, and then you tell them, your father is clear and well-defined, that's your dad. And your mother is clear and well-defined, and that's your mother. Well, the kids are happy. They always know that my dad, that my mom, and life goes on. And then you come to them and you say, there are certain things about you kids that the majority of people do not know, but only a small minority does. That's it. You've planted the first seed of doubt, of confusion, What do you think the children or anyone else who hear this, what you have said, will feel and believe? Well, it is clear the children and the people all will think that these children's paternity and maternity are questionable and that they aren't 100% as they thought. You cannot, you see, when it comes to paternity, maternity is easy. The kid comes from the mother, it's 100% the mother, no problem. But the problem is always the paternity, the father. We men, we cannot accept that this child is 99% my child. It's 100%. That 1% will play a vital role. We cannot. Of course, unless science says there is no such thing as 100%, but let's assume science says there is 100%. So if I go to the hospital and I take my child, I expect 100%. So if somebody comes to me and says, oh, your kid is only 95%, then there is an issue that 5% becomes the biggest issue in the whole situation. This is exactly what this hadith narrative implies. If the halal is clear and defined, and the haram is also clear and defined, how can there be between these two things, things that are unclear and undefined? It just doesn't make sense. And this talk is here to investigate the real reason behind the existence of this hadith narrative and why it was said in the first place. Furthermore, who is behind and who was behind the fabrication of this hadith narrative? And who was behind its marketing? You hear me use a lot hadith narrative because it is just that. You see, the biggest lie that we are told and that you are told and that is being told right now is that the sheikh and the men of religion, they take a narrative and they say the messenger of Allah said, when they know it's 100% agreed amongst the scholars of hadith that any hadith is only a speculation, that it is a probable reason maybe that the messenger has said it. It's not even beyond reasonable doubt. And this is why in the science of hadith, they only study the chain of narrators. They don't study the context. And when they say the hadith is sahih, authentic, they do not mean the content. They mean the chain of narrator is authentic. And of course, as they have it, if the chain of narrator of people is reliable, trustworthy, and all that kind of stuff, then what they have reported must have some degree of truth. And then they attach the messenger of Allah said, and this is the biggest liar. This is what's making people always keep, oh, the messenger said, when in fact he didn't say, it's just, that's why I call it a hadith narrative. Please remember, as I go through this talk, I am just giving you the other side of what you always have been given in Islam. I am not here to tell you what to believe. I'm just like the menu at a fancy restaurant. I don't tell you what to order. I just tell you what's available. And you, from your own 100% free will, decide what to order from that menu. Yes, with passion, I share with you what I believe in, because to me, it is the truth. Of course, if you like it, what I say and what I'm presenting, by all means, make it your own. And by making it your own, I mean go research further what I said. Maybe I made a mistake. Maybe. So go double check what I said. Make it your journey to get into your heart and your mind something you're convinced of. Do not just take what they tell you. Because at the end of the day, this hadith narrative of the halal is clear and the haram is clear, and between them are these confusing matters. This is the hadith that gave the absolute authority to humans to mess around and completely mess Allah's religion. You see, Islam didn't begin with Adam. Al-Islam, as the submission to Allah, was a way of life that Allah has established on this earth since He created the first intelligent life on earth. This way of life evolved, of course, and then Adam was the last of the evolutionary term. And I will get into this, inshallah, when I start talking about the journey of us from before Adam until the end of time and Jannah and beyond. But I will go in details then. But for now, Adam alayhi salam is not the first human, nor is he the father of human. Throughout our history, mankind have always relied on what Allah descended to them, and what Allah has sent down was always in relation to the conditions of humans. You see, when humans were primitive, the laws of Allah were primitive. When humans became like toddlers, the laws and what Allah revealed to them was accordingly. When humans are fully grown and mature, as we are now, Allah sent down the Quran. So always bear this in mind. It's a history between humans and what Allah descends to them. Then as humanity progressed, of course, so did Allah's laws, until the descent of the Torah that Allah descended upon Musa. The Torah, or Taurat, contained 613 well-defined and well-explained laws. All what the children of Israel had to do was just to follow the Torah very closely. But, of course, instead of holding the Torah as a pure word of Allah, and that is what Allah wants from the children of Israel, they went ahead and throughout history and started adding external texts above the Torah. And that's how a Talmud saw life. You see, the Talmud, which means instructions, is a compilation of the oral Torah and oral law that the scholars have understood from the Torah. And then they mingled the two interpretations together and they brought in what the different rabbis had said. And then we have a new religion above a Torah that Allah Ta'ala has revealed. And this is why today you see the Jews, they have so many denominations, disagreement. That is how it progressed from that days until our and maybe the end of time. The Talmud, nonetheless, is regarded by the Orthodox Jews as a prescriptive and a legislating authority as the written Torah. The Jews consider the written Torah, what Musa brought, like the first five books in the Bible today, in the Old Testament. They consider those as a Torah. And At-Talmud just deals with the interpretations and the oral Torah and how people recited it. To the Orthodox Jews, these three sources are one. The oral Torah, the oral law, and the written Torah. So that is one. After Musa came Jesus, son of Mary. Allah descended upon Isa not only the Injil, the Gospel, and this is untrue. Allah gave to Jesus far more than he has given Musa, far more than he has given Muhammad himself. Jesus got the biggest share, and I will get back to this, inshallah, in a little bit. So when Allah descended upon Jesus, al-Injil, what did the Christians do? At first, they followed the laws of the Torah and the Injil, because that's the orders of Allah. Until Paul, which today is counted as Saint Paul, until him, he came into the Islam that Jesus brought, or the Christianity. And then he went ahead and changed Christianity forever. The conversion of Paul to Christianity occurred in less than 10 years from the departure of Jesus, son of Mary. Unless maybe you know, if you have listened to my talk about Jibreel not being an angel, I explained, I gave more information about Paul, but I will give a small snippet here. Paul was a Greek-speaking Jew, and he was from Asia, the minor part of Asia. Today is Turkey. And Paul is the responsible for removing many of what Allah had descended upon Isa. You see, the Bible has many extra books added by humans. And usually, it's in the persona of Paul. I'll give you a small example. The Old Testament is made up of 39 individual books, like for us today in the Quran, we have the surahs. And the New Testament is made up of 27 books. So when you have the Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament, you have 66. as we have 114 surahs. However, later on, in one council of Florence, which took place between 1431 and 1449 in the Christian era in France, the Catholic Church formally affirmed that the criterion of Scripture consists of 46 books in the Old Testament instead of the 39, and 27 in the New Testament. And now we have 73 books instead of 66 books. So you see, the number of books in the Bible was not accepted by all Christian schools of thought. Some Bibles today, they refuse to add the extra 7 books. And one of them, for example, is the King James Version. It only has 66. Others, they have 73. So now when they say the Bible is from Allah, is the holy word of God, which one are we talking about? The 66 books or the 73 books? Now, if the 73 books is holy and come from Allah, why have they removed the other 7 books? Why? And this creates a big problem, causes people to get confused about what is and what is not in Christianity. The Muslim man of religion, our sheikhs and our scholars and all these things, instead of learning from the mistakes that were made by the Jews and Christians, what they did, they went ahead and did exactly like the Jews and Christians and created an auxiliary source of legislation, and they named it the Sunnah. The Jews, they have the Talmud. The Christians, they have the 7 books, give and take, and what Paul has written. And we have what they call the Sunnah. And all these 3 denominations, i.e. the Jews, Christians, and Muslims, denomination of the Abrahamic religion, are all wrong. You see, my dear sisters and my brothers, there are so many hadith narratives that are used to legislate and regulate the life of Muslims. And at the end of this talk, I will briefly mention about 40 of those narratives who have made the life of Muslims a living hell. Well, at least 40. Otherwise, I can really mention thousands of them. And it was not the right of the humans to mess around in Allah's religion. They were not granted that power, that authority. You see, these auxiliary legislations began in the early years of Islam, specifically from year 40. And year 40 is a year that every Sunni Muslim out there, of course, I am not a Sunni, I'm a person who follows the Quran, so they call me Qurani, up to them, but me, I am a Muslim. But the Sunni, the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah denomination, as opposed to the Shia and other people, should learn and learn heavily about what took place in year 40. Why is year 40 so important? And they should also learn about what took place in the 3rd century, the beginning of the end of 2nd century, beginning of the 3rd century, because that is the golden age of the Abbasi dynasty, and why it is important. Both of these 2 dates, the 40th and the 3rd century, are extremely important because they shaped Islam as we know it today and turned it from a divine Islam into a human Islam. You see, in year 40, the civil war has ended, and Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, the leader of that was opposing Ali, hijacked leadership from Al-Hasan, son of Ali, the grandchild of the Messenger of Allah, the son of Fatima. The Shia bank a lot on this, and they made a big fuss of it. And to politically speaking, they're right, because Muawiyah stole the leadership from Al-Hasan. But of course, they use it for other agendas, and they are wrong in doing that. So Muawiyah hijacked the leadership from Al-Hasan, son of Ali. Muawiyah didn't win the war against Ali. But when Ali was cowardly assassinated, the leadership was transferred to his son. The idea of Ali, son Al-Hasan, becoming the leader of Muslims after the assassination of his father didn't, of course, sit well with Muawiyah, because Muawiyah wanted power. After all, Muawiyah had gone into war against Ali for 5 continuous years with thousands upon thousands of dead people. And these thousands, many of these thousands were what they call companions. And they should know better. That's why you are kept in the dark about what took place, about the civil war. Because so many hadith paint the companions like angelic people, that people are just descended. Oh my, they are the best of generation. They actually are the worst of generations because of the wars and the killings they did. And they know better. But anyhow. So the majority of the people at the time of Muawiyah had seen and lived what the Messenger of Allah preached. And how the good people should have been at that time. So what the first thing that Muawiyah did after taking the power of Al-Hasan, the agreement was as such that Al-Hasan would renounce the throne, so to speak. It was not throne, back then it was still Khalifa, leadership, and things like that, to Muawiyah, on the understanding that when Muawiyah dies, it goes back to Al-Hasan. That was the understanding. But Al-Hasan, the grandchild of the Messenger of Allah, was killed, assassinated, just like his dad. Except Al-Hasan was poisoned. That's it. So, and then the other brother, Al-Hussein, was also decapitated and brutally murdered. These are the grandchildren of the Messenger of Allah. Allah al-Azim, the history, it's bloody history when you go to it. But anyhow, so when Muawiyah took the leadership from Al-Hasan, the very first thing he did, Muawiyah, was to change the identity of the ruling system from a democratic government, democratic quote-unquote, and take this with a pinch of salt, because from Abu Bakr to Umar to Uthman to Ali, there is nothing democratic about that. But it was better than what was to come, and what is today for the Arab world. So Muawiyah changed that democratic government to a kingdom and appointed himself as the first king in Islam. He was the first king to recruit the sheikhs and scholars and use them to promote his ideologies. Muawiyah was the first man to make a monthly wages for the sheikhs and scholars. And he used the religious institution to control the crowds of believers. Muawiyah was the first person to use Islam to the benefit of politics, to the throne. He was the first man to use the sheikhs as a manipulation tool. After Banu Umayyah diligently deviated from the correct Islam line and they started using it now to their hands and to their benefit, it became clear to everyone that their goal was not to establish truth and whatever, but it was to rule and control over the nation's capabilities and riches. And that all their concern of Banu Umayyah was to devote all this kingdom to their pleasures and desires. And those pleasures and desires, wherever they may be. Whoever was close to them enjoyed his life, and whoever was against them would perish and be killed. Muslims at that time had enough of Muawiyah and his doings. And the revolutions and strifes against Muawiyah and Banu Umayyah after him started increasing throughout the land. Name it, Iraq, Iran, Syria, Lebanon, all these places started boiling. What happened? Muawiyah doesn't have enough armies to launch a war against all these people. And so he resorted to a very sneaky and dangerous technique that is still implemented today. He used the sheikhs to control the masses. He pays with the sheikh well, and the sheikh will preach to people not to go against the ruler, not to do anything. Of course, at first that didn't work, because they never ever tell Muslims today the wars and the revolts that took place in the early days. For example, I'm just going to give you a couple of them, yeah? There is the one, it's called the Battle of Al-Harra, and it took place in Al-Madinah. The reason of this extreme revolt and assassinations and bloodshed was when Muawiyah wanted to get the allegiance to the people for his crown prince Yazid. Muawiyah, remember, it was the covenant that Muawiyah should return the leadership to Al-Hasan or to the children of Al-Hasan. And now Muawiyah wants Yazid, his son, the crown prince, to be the king when Muawiyah dies. And to do that, Muawiyah started sending his mercenaries and his people to brainwash people into accepting Yazid. Al-Madina of Rasulullah, the world messenger, died, did not accept the offer of Muawiyah. After give and take, then armies were dispatched from Syria all the way to Al-Madina. And there has been a blood shed in that Medina. Even books of history say that thousands of Muslim virgin women of Al-Madina lost their virginity because of the amount of vengeance. Muawiyah wanted to make Al-Madina a lesson for everyone else, and he succeeded. They don't tell you, nobody tells you about Al-Hara, and I will, inshallah, as I progress in my upcoming series about our lives from before Adam until the, when I speak about the life of Muhammad and the history, I will mention these because it's your right to know. Because what happened back then is implicating and applying to Islam today. Later on, there was another revolt. It's called the Thawrat al-Mukhtar wa Tawabin. A people who also wanted to repent to Allah by allowing Muawiyah to do as he did. And it ended up with a lot of blood shed. There is another revolution of the scholars of Al-Kufa and Al-Iraq. A bunch of scholars, around 100, 120 of them, revolted against Muawiyah. And the war went on, and it was years in the killings and assassinations. After that was another Thawrat Abdullah ibn Az-Zubayr, who occupied Mecca and established himself as Khalifa again. So all these revolutions, the number of revolutions are high and big, and I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about them, but those revolutions gave idea to Muawiyah. Those ideas were military. Confrontation would not yield results. What can he do to win the throne and end all these revolts? And that's then when he thought about employing and using the sheikhs to control people. I will give you just one example of such manipulation. Muawiyah used to go around the cities and towns to talk to people for acceptance, so that they accept him. But Muawiyah was not accepted by the people, and this posed a big problem for him, because every time he ascended the minbar, because back then they used to say the Khalifa, the king, or whoever was in authority, it was him who gives the khutbah of Jum'ah, the Jum'ah prayer sermon. Muawiyah would go to ascend the minbar or the pulpit and to speak to people. But when he, back then, it was free. The sheikh would give the Jum'ah khutbah, and if he said something wrong, people would object and argue with him. So when Muawiyah would go and talk, people wouldn't accept what he says, and there was give and take. Imagine, he's given the sermon, the khutbah, and people are giving and taking with him. That, of course, that arguing didn't work well with Muawiyah. And then they resorted to something else. As you know, back then the masjid didn't have carpets. It was all you sit on a pebble, you sit on the dust, on the earth, on the ground. When Muawiyah said something that they didn't like, they used to take pebbles and they used to pebble Muawiyah. And you know, pebbles are small rocks. So they would throw them at Muawiyah. Imagine someone is talking and every time you are hit by a pebble. Even at one point, Muawiyah cut the hand of a man. Kind of like to make him a lesson, but that didn't work. People kept pebbling Muawiyah. And then what did Muawiyah do? He called upon his trusted ally, the religious institution, and asked them to find a solution to this growing problem. Every time I stand on the pulpit, the minbar, to give a khutbah, people are arguing with me, people are pebbling me, people are hitting me with rocks, and I can't order killings every Jum'ah. And that is when the sheikhs came up with this diabolical idea, and they fabricated a hadith and linked it to Rasulullah, and that hadith narrative is still enforced today. If anyone performs wudu properly, then comes to the Friday prayer, listens to the khutbah,
that the Imam gives the religious talk attentively and keeps silent, his sins between that Friday and the following Friday will be forgiven, with the addition of 3 more days. And he who touches pebbles has caused a useless activity. And this hadith narrative is in Muslim. And you can see politics here 100%. Pay attention. The reward, all the sins will be forgiven for the next 7 days and another 3 days extra. So, you do 4 Jum'ahs in a month and you get the reward of 40 days. That's what it is. And this is ridiculous. If that is the case, why is there judgment day for Muslims? But anyhow, so it starts with he who touches pebbles has committed a useless activity. But it didn't stop here, you see. It went further. In another hadith narrative by Al-Bukhari, it says, anyone who takes a bath on Friday and cleans himself as much as he can, puts oil on his hair or perfume oil for beautification, and then proceeds to the prayers, and now listen to the conditions. All of these conditions work absolutely fantastic for Muawiyah. One, does not force his way between two persons, i.e. when you enter the masjid, just sit, don't keep jumping on people. Two, prays as much as is written for them, i.e. engage in salat. Do not talk to people, because if people sit in a masjid and they start talking and they are not happy with politics and Muawiyah, and at that time they were. So they start talking, you see, they start plotting, and someone might throw an idea and they do it later. So this hadith tells people, do not talk to people, occupy yourself with salat. And number three is to remain quiet when the imam delivers the khutbah. Of course, you get all the sins in between the present Jum'ah and furthermore 3 days after that. And this is in Al-Bukhari. Things even get more dangerous. See, when the teacher of Al-Bukhari and Muslim, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, who is the teacher of these two, in his narrative, in his book of hadith narratives, adds the following. If anyone speaks on Friday while the imam is preaching, he is like a donkey who carries books of guidance. And he who tells that person who is talking, be quiet, will get no reward for this Jum'ah prayer. In other words, if you are in Jum'ah and someone is talking and you tell them, be quiet, both of you have lost the reward of Jum'ah. In other words, when someone does something on Jum'ah and talks and wants to do a revolt, you 100% ignore them, or your Jum'ah has been missed and you get no reward. You see, the authenticity of this hadith narrative is, as usual, the highest rank, because Bukhari, Muslim, speak a hadith, it becomes more authentic than the Quran itself. You see, when you enter the masjid on Jum'ah and the imam is giving a khutbah, if you say Assalamu Alaikum, nobody is going to answer you. Why? Because the hadith says, do not talk, because you don't want to mess your Jum'ah. And by doing that, what have they done? They completely ignored what Allah says in the Quran. Allah says, وَإِذَا حَيِّيتُم بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّهَا. And if you are saluted or with a greeting, respond with a better one or just return it. Allah did not exclude the situation. If you are in somehow and someone says a greeting to you, Allah says the minimum, return it. Good morning, good morning, end of it. But the best option is to say something better than them. Good morning, oh good morning, how you doing? So that is something nice. But for us Muslims who are under the spell of the hadith narratives, if someone says Assalamu Alaikum to you when you are in masjid on a Jum'ah, they get ignored. Back to Muawiyah. It was in Muawiyah's time that the term of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah was coined and adopted. Since that era, this name or this title of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah means only one thing. People who supported Muawiyah and were against his enemies. And that's what the Salafis are for today. Since they were given big powers, those Salafis, the man of religion took their liberties at pushing Muawiyah's agendas, and they succeeded greatly at doing that. Now, the hadith of don't touch the pebbles, don't argue, don't do nothing, or your Jum'ah is missed, has spread like wildfire on the land. And now the Muawiyah and his governors, wherever they go, they say what they want. Nobody talks to them because nobody wants to lose their Jum'ah. That hadith narrative still exists today. Until the sheikhs, you hear them, at the time of the messenger, there were pebbles and people touched them. Today we don't have pebbles, we have carpets, we have cemented floors. And now they jumped into, don't touch your watch. And I've seen people when they go to Jum'ah, they remove the watch from their wrists, put it in their pockets. Why? Scared that they touch it. If they put the phone, they don't touch it. I have seen parents, both as someone who attends the Jum'ah and someone who gave the khutbah. I have seen parents, the children are crying, but the father does absolutely not a thing. Why? Because he is scared of losing the reward of his Jum'ah. Had he studied a little bit of history, he would have found out that the whole idea about the Jum'ah is a hoax and a control technique that is used by the men of religion for the benefit of the kings and queens. It's sad. It really is a sad affair ignoring our history. The sheikhs at the time of Muawiyah, especially at the time from the time of Muawiyah and after, were given an almost unlimited powers to do with Allah's religion as they please. Really, it's incredible. That's why so many hadith narratives have been fabricated and for a variety of different topics. Most of these hadiths were to control the masses and make Muslims, the Muslim public, submit to the new self-appointed king, Muawiyah. Even to our day and age in the 21st century, books are written about how Muawiyah was great, and anyone who talks against Muawiyah is a hypocrite. That's it. We can't. Why? All these attacks on free thinking, on us, people who don't accept these things, are made to keep the past, the history, hidden, and all the darknesses tucked inside. That's it. We can't do anything. The sheikhs were experts at inventing hadith. After all, they know how to make a chain of narrators. If you go to a farmer, to someone who is in the market buying and selling, and you ask them to fabricate a hadith, even if they spoke good Arabic, they wouldn't be able to. Because the moment you ask them about the chain of narrators, who did you hear it from, they get stuck. But if you went to a sheikh, to a scholar back in time, and you ask them, as Muawiyah did, to fabricate a hadith, they know, A, they have the ability of the good Arabic, so they know how to words the content. And then to find a chain of narrators is also extremely easy. They know who of the narrators is trustworthy, and all they have to do is just create an imaginary chain of narrators, and the hadith gets accepted. Let me give you, please allow me to introduce to you one of such scholars. One, I can speak more, but just one would do, because as I said, I want to keep this talk a little bit tight and short, so to speak. So this man's name is Ismail ibn Abi Uwais. Remember this name, Ismail ibn Abi Uwais, because he will make a declaration that will explain to you why I, Abdussalam, and many scholars before me, for the centuries that have gone by, have rejected them. Some of them rejected all the hadith except 400, others 4,000, other 1,000, other the whole thing, other just stuck with the Quran. But of course, you don't get told about these people. Because as far as the Salafi school of thought, the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, all these people are deviant and kuffar and whatever have you. But the idea of just taking the Quran alone is not a disease of the 21st century, as they like to put it. It actually has always been there. And I will come back to this, inshallah, later on. I will give you names of people of the companions and after them that rejected what is today called the Sunnah and the Hadith. This Ismail ibn Abi Uwais died in 226 Hijri, i.e., he died around the 3rd century. Okay, that's it. And what happens to this man is a subject of great controversy. Some scholars insist that he is good, reliable, and a pious scholar, while others say no, he is a liar, a deceiver, and a hadith fabricator. And this exists, and so the sheikh, or the scholar of hadith, that considers Ismail ibn Abi Uwais as a good, reliable, and a pious scholar, would accept his hadith and makes it authentic. But the other part of the sheikhs who see that Ismail ibn Abi Uwais is a liar, deceiver, and a hadith fabricator will reject his hadith. And now you have one group of people that say this man is good, that such his hadith is authentic. Others say no, he is a bad person and his hadiths are not authentic. And you find in our books today a hadith that are considered authentic and they are reported by this man. So then again, what is this controversy about? Why is he like this? Well, it's simple really. See, Bukhari and Muslim have collected hadiths from him, from this Ismail ibn Abi Uwais. Al-Bukhari, for example, collected 17 hadith, and Muslim collected much less than that. All right? So the scholars agreed not to accept. Now, this is the problem when it starts occurring and how humans tamper with Allah's Islam. The scholars after Bukhari and Muslim agreed between themselves, and when they say agreed, they didn't kind of like hold a meeting and came up. No. It's each one of them goes their route and someone says, oh, that one agrees with that one. Okay. And the other one, yeah, that also. And then they wrote, the scholars agreed. There was no meeting, there was no conference, there was nothing. And then they came up with a joint agreement. It doesn't happen like that. But anyhow, they say the scholars agreed not to accept any of his hadiths, except those reported in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. Meaning, if Bukhari reports his hadith, the hadith is accepted of Ismail ibn Abi Uwais. If Muslim reports his hadith, it is accepted. But if Abu Dawood, Ibn Majah, At-Tirmidhi, Ahmad, or anyone else reports a hadith from Ismail ibn Abi Uwais, that hadith is to be rejected. So why this controversy? Why is this quarrel and the verbal altercations between the men of Islam about this man? Well, this man is, as they describe, is as follows. He, i.e. Ismail ibn Abi Uwais, is the son of the sister of Malik ibn Anas. Malik ibn Anas is the founder of the Maliki school of thought, found greatly in northern parts of Africa, Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, Libya, and the parts of Egypt. But it's concentrated in northern parts of Africa. So this Ismail ibn Abi Uwais is the son, Malik ibn Anas, the leader of the school of thought, has got a sister, and Ismail ibn Abi Uwais is her son. All right? They say that all the hadiths reported from this man, except the ones in An-Nasa'i. So they added to Al-Bukhari and Muslim a third one called An-Nasa'i. So if An-Nasa'i, Bukhari, Muslim, report from Ismail ibn Abi Uwais, the hadith is accepted. All right. They call him al-imam. And in the terminology of the scholars, in our al-sunnah al-jama'ah scholars, when someone is called an imam, they mean he is a great leading authority in Islam. So Ismail ibn Abi Uwais, who has been described as a liar, deceiver, and a hadith fabricator, is now an imam. By those who accept him, they consider him to be an imam, a leading authority in Islam. And they even call him Al-Hafidh. Al-Hafidh is a title, the memorizer, like the English translation. And the Hafidh to them, the memorizer, is someone who at least memorizes 100,000 hadiths to the maximum of 300,000 hadiths. And then above that, they give him another higher title. Mr. Ismail ibn Abi Uwais is also called As-Saduq, i.e. he is a non-stop truthful teller. Subhanallah. Half of the scholars, they say he's a liar, a deceiver, and a hadith fabricator. The other ones, they say he's good, reliable, and a pious scholar. Not only that, he is a leading authority. He knows, he is classified as someone, a memorizer of the hadith between 100,000 and 300,000, and he is a total truthful teller. So why the controversy? Why the disagreement? Well, it's simple, really. It's because of a statement he made. And this statement is reported in the book of Al-Nasa'i and other books of that speak about the biographies of the reporters of hadith. Here is what this Ismail ibn Abi Uwais said. He said, كنت أضع الحديث لأهل المدينة إذا اختلفوا في شيء فيما بينهم. This is his verdict in Arabic. But in English he says, I used to fabricate hadiths for the people of Al-Madinah, because he used to live in Al-Madinah, if they disagreed on something between them. What he's saying is this: when the people of Madinah disagreed over an issue, he, Ismail ibn Uwais, would come and lie to them by fabricating some hadith narrative to support one group or one opinion or one argument over the other, as he sees it. As he sees it, then would attribute the lie to the messenger of Allah. And people would stop that arguing. Why? Because the messenger of Allah has spoken through Ismail ibn Abi Uwais. This is the man that Bukhari and Muslim and the rest of the hadith community trusted our Islam to. He, with his own words at the time of death, said, I used to fabricate hadith for the people of Al-Madina if they disagreed on something between them. This is just one example. One example of a liar. And to some of our sheikhs, they consider him a leading authority in Islam. A man who tells the truth continuously. Ismail ibn Abi Uwais is one such a liar that has had the courage to lie and then admit that he used to purposefully fabricate lies, make them seem and sound like a hadith narrative, then would attribute that to the messenger of Allah. All this while keeping a straight face and acts as if he was a very pious person on Allah's earth. You see, the purpose of this hadith narrative of the halal and haram appears to seemingly be a harmless, really harmless narrative. It just says the halal is known, the haram is known, between them some issues and end of it, right? From outside, it gives you the impression that it's talking about something simple. The message of Allah so much cared about Muslims that he wanted to warn them about not falling in what can hurt them. But the reality of the matter is, this hadith narrative isn't at all about this fact of making things simple for us. It is the most harmful and dangerous hadith to Islam and Muslims. And by the end of this talk, you'll understand why. It is the most poisonous hadith narrative in the whole of Islam. The purpose of this hadith narrative is far more sinister, far more dark than you can ever imagine. The brute reason behind the existence of this hadith narrative of the halal and haram, clear and between, I call it the halal and the haram and the in-between hadith narrative, was invented to grant the men of religion and the religious institutions behind them ultimate, unlimited powers to decide and dictate for Muslims everything about Islam. Since they are the minority who knows and the majority doesn't know, the minority can say anything and the majority accepts that anything. And that's exactly what happened. This hadith narrative gave and still gives the men of religion and the religion institutions behind them, like the University of Al-Azhar or any university in Saudi Arabia, or the high ministry and departments of religious affairs in any Muslim countries. That's what I mean by religious institutions. This hadith narrative of the halal and the haram gave and still gives these people ultimate powers to regulate and legislate every part of the Muslim life today. This hadith narrative puts the man of religion as leaders, really leaders and legislators, all done in the name of Allah. That's why in your mind, a sheikh has to dress in certain manner, has to speak in certain way, has to act in certain manner. When they do, you accept them as a figure of Islam and you think of them as good people. A long beard, cover the head, wear a qamis, and that's it, you are a sheikh. It's really disturbing, my dear sister and brothers, what this hadith has done to us. The men of religion today act as if they are prophets and messengers. To further affirm their position as an authority, an undisputable and unchallenged authority in Islam, they invented another hadith that is also extremely dangerous. I will stop here and carry on, inshallah, in part two, as the time is reaching the 50 minutes mark. And off to the second part. Assalamu alaikum. This is again your brother.